Welcome everybody to Trinity Talks, The Road Less Travelled. My name is Dorothy Mayer-Holcomb. Oh, sorry, and I forgot the microphone, so I'm just going to do that again. I thought I was missing something. Right. Okay, here we go again. Welcome everybody to Trinity Talks, The Road Less Travelled. My name is Dorothy Mayer-Holcomb, and I'm the series producer with NeuroFM. I'd like to welcome our audience here in Trinity Long Room Hub and also our audience on NeuroFM. The Road Less Travelled is the second collaboration between Trinity Long Room Hub and NeuroFM, following on from our women's series back in 2019. And I also want to welcome everybody watching and listening in on Facebook. Over the course of these conversations, we'll meet current and past students from Trinity College Dublin who have taken the road less travelled to education. Men and women from all walks of life who have overcome social, prejudicial, and even geographical barriers, all for the opportunity to further their education. At the end of the conversation, there'll be an opportunity to ask questions or make a comment. Please do. For our audience joining us on Facebook, we'd be delighted to hear any comments or questions you may have. So please write them into the chat and we'll bring them in at the end of our conversation. For our audience here in the Hub, we ask you to raise your hand and wait until the microphone is there so we can record the question as well. This episode will be broadcast on NeuroFM on Wednesday, December 1st at 4:30 p.m. with the podcast available afterwards. Now, on to the reason why we are all here today. We're delighted to be joined by Karim Al Abbasi, who is going to speak about his inspirational journey that has taken him from war-torn Syria to Trinity College Dublin. Karim will be in conversation with Roja Fazaeli, Assistant Professor in Islamic Civilizations in Trinity College Dublin. And now I'm going to hand over to you, Roja.
Thank you very much for your introduction. So Karim, it's good to meet you again. We had a lovely chat this morning. And you know, I was an undergraduate student in Trinity. And, yeah. And actually sharing our stories, we found that we have a lot in common. Maybe we can start with talking about your journey from Syria in the sense of kind of from peace to war in some senses, because you said you were 7 when the conflict in Syria started. And so how was life, and you said you're from Latakia as well in Syria.
Yeah, exactly.
How was life in Latakia? And Latakia, you said, is beside the sea as well. If you could just tell us about kind of your childhood there and share with the audience as well.
Okay, so hi everyone. So basically, the life in Syria generally is all about the closeness of like family members and people, and like people that are so like welcoming and they warm-hearted, and it's normally people are like so peaceful and they're so open-minded. So I was raised in Latakia basically, and it's very nice, beautiful city. It's has like beautiful nature, delicious food, so and also very touristic site for tourists in Syria, like besides the capital and Aleppo. I basically used to go to my relative every week, to my grandmother, and sometimes go to my sister. She's married, by the way, so everything like used to be like very peaceful. There's no like, it's a very beautiful place, very peaceful place, and normally tourists really enjoy it. So when the war broke in 2011, I was actually so little, like I was 7. So the sad part of this is that I didn't get to like have that typical Syrian life as Syrian, because I was so little, because all my siblings and my family had opportunities. I mean, they're obviously all older than me, so they had opportunities to travel around the country and have the experience that Syrians would. So I didn't get the opportunity to enjoy my culture, basically. So when the war started, it was actually a very stressful experience, and at the beginning, we would hear like some bombing, some gun shooting around the city, like the first few months. So it was a very stressful experience, especially as a child, because that's really a very unique experience to have in the country. Like a few months later, the situation in my city cooled down, so it was kind of a lucky thing that happened, unlike the other cities where most of the buildings were kind of fully damaged. So in Latakia, even though like it was kind of safe in terms of like not like the non-existence of gun shooting and the conflict in that region, like the economic situation of the city and the like services provided, they all went like very like worse basically. So starting from the electricity, before the war we didn't really have used to have like very rare power cut of electricity. Like after the war it started coming gradually from having like 2 hours of power cut a day to like 16 hours a day, and now like right now it's people I find it so hard because I only get like an hour every of electricity every 6 hours. So yeah, it's really sad.
I suppose that's one of the things that you think about, kind of, you know, the side of conflict that is bombings and shootings, that obviously there are parts of the country that have like experienced that extendedly. And then your part where you said, obviously, when you were seven, you would hear the gunshots and the bombings, but the whole economic side of it, and when you have electricity cuts, and we talked about this as well, where you know, I'm from Iran, and we share many kind of common stories. But whereas I was born in the war, you were seven when the war happened, and I remember with electricity cuts actually, and we talked about this, that it was the same for us, especially at nighttime doing your homework
exactly.
under the gas kind of little lights. And I kind of, was it oil lamps, not gas lamps? And I kind of still like remember the scent, the smell of it. And you were saying you basically, that's how you studied with the power cuts. And
yeah,
power
exactly.
cuts is one side of it. Yeah,
yeah, so I did like my certificate, like basically we also have like something equivalent to junior cert here.
Yeah.
So it's basically like Syrian junior certificate. So I actually, it was kind of, like I was so lucky that I was managed to study doing all these, like the power cut and bath services that we had, and I got like a very high mark in my junior cert, like I guess 97%, so which is really good. So yeah, like that's actually something that's so memorable to me from like being in Syria. Especially that schools there like didn't have, for example, heating in winter or some like educational services that like schools, let's say in Europe, in European Union would get. So, and I mean, even the Middle East, like Syria had a lot of problem with providing educational services in that sense.
That's it. That's after the war.
After
the war. So previous to that, you would have had better services and
yeah.
educational services. And you were also talking about how it wasn't only the resources available or not available in the schools, but also the fact that the teachers, you didn't have, the teachers are getting paid so little
Yeah,
maybe you
basically everyone like all people from all careers, like, was impacted like heavily from the war. I mean, and those who still had like jobs, well, had like very like large decrease in their wages, like. So that's how what impacted. So everyone there is only focusing on their like just to provide basically the basic needs for their family, especially like getting bread and like fuel. Yeah, especially that also can get like very cold in winter and very hot in summer. So that's why the people sometimes. Like show their struggle and their the impact that the war had on them.
Yeah, and again, this is something that you know we share the memory of in queuing for bread is one of my memories from childhood, and I was kind of the youngest in the family, so I used to be sent to queue. But you know, and part of it was like life becomes so routine around
exactly,
the time
people
of conflict.
Just like got
that,
used to it after
yeah.
that, like. And that was like in parts of the island, and even in the part of the country where lots of buildings were damaged and lots of people were like unfortunately died, like it's still people got used to it, like you know what I mean?
You become, yeah, especially if you're a child, it's part of childhood, queuing for bread, going to funerals,
yeah,
and family who've died in war or have been, you know, in conflict as well. So then you did really well in your junior cert. What was then the prospects if you had a state in Syria, education-wise? What were you planning to do?
I was basically planning to get my baccalaureate certificate, which is equivalent to the leaving cert. So I would have also struggled with, like, was the power cut again, but so like I didn't really have like a future perspective that I will be in, that I will move from Syria, so it was kind of unexpected that my brother who moved from Syria in 2015 managed to get us like a reunification visa to get here. So
yeah,
so it's kind of like a new experience for me. When we moved here, we struggled a little bit with the like things like a new culture and maybe like getting adjusted to the language and getting settled in. Like we're thankful that. Like I'm so thankful that I live here and I study here right now.
And I never asked you this, Karim, like what was your level of English before coming to Ireland? Because you did your leaving cert pretty soon after you got here. And it's tough to do leaving cert in another language.
Yeah, I know. Basically we do have like, in Syria we do have like a compulsory subject for English. So like all students have to study English and pass it. Even though English classes didn't have the requirements to have like some audio teachings and like audio exams, so it was mostly just reading and theory. I did have a very good compared to what we need to like the skills that we need to do for the junior cert are actually like so good at English, so I'll like used to get like full marks in it, and also on Sino I also have used to like support my English skills with you know, listening to songs and watching movies basically.
What songs and what movies did you?
And normally listen to. To like pop songs, so like I mean it's kind of fun. Also, and sometimes I listen to for example, Queen. So I actually learned like most of the lecturers, I learned them from like listening to songs basically. So so that's why basically, and especially after I knew that I would move to Ireland, I devoted my whole time to actually study English, because I knew that I would travel to Ireland in July 2018. So like I just like spent the last 3 months before that date studying English basically, just to secure my life here and support my family. And something I didn't mention in our chat, that when we arrived here, I tried to help like with my English like proficiency. I've always helped my family with something, with documents from government, medical appointments, like speaking on behalf of my parents, basically. So I also, that's really supported like my journey in improving my English.
Yeah, no, your English is absolutely excellent. I thought about it actually when you said you did your leaving cert, because I did my leaving cert as well after a few years. We came and I found it quite tough, especially the English.
Yeah.
And, you know, you have to read all these like Shakespeare and very, very hard texts. And if you've only been doing English for a few years, but I was, anyway, very impressed when we spoke earlier and now as well, of your level of fluency. And that's actually like, you know, talking about the movies and watching kind of movies in English and listening to pop songs and being a fan of Queens, just reminded me of when we were talking earlier, and you were saying, you know, it's a pity the way kind of Middle East and Syria is seen in the media and to the outside world, because it's kind of it's seen as just, you know, it's a place of conflict and people flooding, but obviously there is a rich culture and it's not separated.
Exactly.
It's also part of the globalized world.
Yeah. It's really sad because like I think like in Syria we literally do have like all the resources for it to be like a very famous place with like its nature and its food and its, all the touristic attractions and all the I mean it was obviously ruled by several empires during the past, and it was like a road that connected to, especially that area, it connects like the whole three continents, like of Asia, Europe and Africa. So yeah, it's really sad.
Yeah, hopefully we'll come to a time where you can go back and
exactly.
It becomes that especially Latakia, where you talk about it, that could be a very touristic attraction, a place for a lot of people to visit. But let's come back to kind of Ireland and your journey here.
Yeah.
So you came here to join your brother and his family on a reunification visa, and you came with your family, with your mom, dad, and your...
Yeah, my other brother.
Your other brother. So when you came to Ireland, you said you were living in the city centre for a while, and then you lived in Milltown for a while. But given the situation of housing in Ireland, that became more and more difficult, especially paying for rent and finding a place. Maybe you can speak to that, because I'm sure a lot of the students, whether from Ireland or not, are finding it very, very difficult to find proper housing, adequate housing. That's, you know, a big debate in Ireland right now. Not just for students, but here I suppose the audience is mainly students.
Yeah, so basically we had to live in a direct provision center for a year and a half because of the housing crisis, obviously. So it was kind of like a very strange experience, was like fluctuating feelings, because I always want to at least have like some house here in Ireland so I can studying like even like have a more an easier environment to study in. So during the COVID times, we were actually so lucky that we were granted a house to live in, and we now just pay like an accessible like a suitable rent every week. So, but however, like even during my time where I stayed in the in that like in these tight rooms in the province centers, most people like from around the world living with us in that buildings. I actually did continue studying. I did hope like to achieve my like high marks in my leaving certs. So that didn't. So like me living in Provincial Center didn't really prevent me from progressing like in my life in Ireland, basically.
But you talked about it exactly. You know that it's a tight space, and
yeah,
this was during COVID time.
Yeah.
In many ways you've done so exceptionally well to have been able to progress and study in that environment. But I suppose there are examples of young people within direct provision where they find it quite challenging, given the space they have and the challenges they face. But I don't know if you know of anyone or you have anything to kind of to add to that.
Well, I know it can be like a very challenging time, especially that we didn't really know that I will start living in a house, because I was kind of like a little bit hopeless at that time, and I obviously continued on like progressing and working, but it was also kind of a difficult time because I was also told that I wouldn't be able to go to college, especially in the last year in the Prison Center. I was told that I wouldn't be able to go to college because of my residency status, because I had been in Ireland for 2 years, and the minimum like residency in Ireland should be 3 years for like international student to go to college. So, but like all like the advice I would give to people living here in Ireland, especially, is just to be patient, and just to not lose hope, because Ireland is a very good place to be working on, and be studying. So,
I agree with you. Having been in Ireland for many years, it's quite a warm and hospitable place. But I suppose if you come from a place where you had your family, you had your extended family,
yeah,
and then you're put in direct provision, where you are with a lot of strangers from different cultures, it could be quite challenging.
Yeah,
in many
ways. I agree.
But so then after that as well, Karim, you were saying that you got familiar with. So you were doing your leaving cert. But you wrote to different universities and told them about your situation, and then you came across Trinity Access Program. Maybe you can tell us then about your journey then from direct provision and to doing your leaving cert and coming to Trinity Access Program. And that was last year when you were,
yeah,
because now
exactly.
you're in a full-time,
yeah, like
degree
now
in computer science.
Formally in like a degree, like a full-time degree now. So it's computer science basically. So like last year during summer, around times of my leaving cert results, that was actually a little bit a very difficult time. That was like a very difficult time for me, because I was kind of hoping that I will go to college straight away and not like have a gap year, like doing nothing. So basically, because I contacted many colleges, I got a call from Sarah Grimson, and she's here by the way, and she told me about the foundation course and the ASAP scholarship and the TAP section, and she also introduced me that I could like spend this year studying and preparing for college, like without like, you know, spending, doing nothing. So I thought it would be like a very good opportunity for me, especially that I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do in college. So I thought that year would be like a perfect chance for me to have. So basically I applied to foundation course and I applied to this ASAP scholarship too. And I was basically accepted like in foundation course, and as soon as I got in it, it was like a very new experience for me because I hadn't been in college before. So staff there was like so welcoming, and they're so easygoing, and they introduced like things in very clear way, and we got to have like some sort of college experience there, like even like before I get into like my degree. Well, it was fully online, but like I still got learned a lot about college, college experience that I would have like the following year, which is this year. I really liked foundation course. It was a very unique experience. Like I met a lot of new people, and I had like a different perspective of college. So I really recommend like all students, especially students in my case, and those who are asylum seekers, to just have read over the foundation course and staff section, as they're like so helpful.
Yeah, no, I suppose that was one of my questions to you as well, which you already answered in like how did you come across Trinity Access Program. So you reached out yourself in this case, I'm really interested as well in the fact that you chose computer science, because we talked about this, that I did computer science. I did computational linguistics with French for my first degree in Trinity as well, but I was awful at programming. You talked about how you seem to grasp it and to know where you're going with your programs, whereas I used to program little those robots. And they used to always go in a loop.
It's actually the section of programming where like lots of students find very challenging, and I agree. This is where I advise students to actually pay particular attention to, and this is where students start to rethink about computer science. Like I actually eventually like the concept of it because it does match my way of thinking. I normally like math and like STEM subjects. I'm more into like analytical thinking, so like math and problem solving, which I thought that computer science would actually have all of these like stuff integrated. And especially I also like learning languages. Like I mentioned that you did computer science and linguistics, which I also thought of doing. So I mean, I like learning grammar in languages, like the way people think in that language, and like how they interpret things, especially language from different families, especially that, I'm like an Arabic speaker, and I learned English, so I had a view on Romance language, and I think my next step would be Germanic language and even Asian language, like Farsi or Chinese, who knows?
Yeah, Farsi should be very easy to learn.
I believe so.
But maybe near Middle Eastern is that where I am, would offer Persian in a few years. But there are opportunities, hopefully, for you maybe to do Erasmus program where you can go to another country.
Exactly, that would be in my third year, hopefully.
Definitely in your third year. But generally, you're enjoying Trinity and being a student here.
Yeah, it is. I really enjoy it. It's very like welcoming space for people from different communities and different like religions, different perspective, different opinions, and they all just get along. I really like that aspect of the university, where especially because in Syria, like the war, one of the biggest impacts is that we didn't get to socialize with people because we didn't have tourists obviously during the war. So that's why I've always wanted to meet people from different countries, different cultures, different communities, for like, so that was like, one of the things I like the most about being in Trinity, because everywhere I go, there's people that I can speak to, be comfortable with, even regardless of the differences that we have. And some of them have a very similar experience.
Yeah, no, absolutely. We have a very diverse student
exactly.
body, but also, you know, like university is where you make your friends for life,
yeah.
And so it's a very meaningful time. I was actually thinking as well of something else you said during the war in Syria, the time that you were in Syria. You used the word lockdown.
Yeah.
You said we were in lockdown effectively because you had to stay in your own district
first few months because we didn't like have that much danger in our like governorate, like our district, like our basically part of Syria that I came from, it's kind of a little dangerous to travel around the country for other cities, especially like even the cities that were like just beside Latakia were heavily affected, which is sad, obviously. But yeah, I mean, I thought that word lockdown generally during COVID really reminded me of the war in Syria. Basically, it's a very similar situation, like a different color, obviously, but like a very similar view if you think about it. Because in both situations, you have to be safe. You have to look out for yourself and for people's safety. So that's why I thought the word lockdown does precisely describe the experience I had. So obviously, Syrians are really used to these kind of experiences, so that's why COVID situation in general wasn't that much of a new experience,
yeah.
A new time to live in. You know what I mean?
So I suppose like it's one experience that is shared in many conflict contexts.
Yeah.
Where you have to stay in a particular place. As you said, one of the experiences you have missed was in Syria, traveling around as
yeah.
Others would have done before the conflict. But you know, it again, like, you know, I was thinking about the whole electricity cut, like 16 hours a day. So that's presently. So you said you get 30 minutes of electricity every 6 hours.
Yeah,
Like
30 minutes to 45 minutes, like to an hour sometimes. Like that's basically the case. It's so sad because especially during like the seasons like that extreme weather, like during the cold, during the winter, for example, the winter can be very cold there, and most people like have no heating. And that's why loads of children who don't have shelter there to die sometimes during winter, which is horrible. And even summer when we have like hot weather, it's also a challenging time.
And I suppose as well with education, like if you only have so few minutes, like 30 minutes here, 30 minutes there, Like, if you have online education, you can't really access that.
Yeah, exactly. You say online education?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because...
like the same way you said, like, your education
exactly,
last year
especially
was
that,
online.
We didn't... Like, online education wouldn't be very, very supported there. After the war, a lot of jobs didn't integrate that use of computers there, and so a lot of people would struggle with online learning, and especially the internet connection even makes it worse there. I believe people are really struggling, and now with COVID, people are dying. Lots of people are, especially like the older ones, are dying due to COVID. Because sometimes we don't get like the same COVID help that, like, let's say people countries in the European Union would.
Yeah. And it is a stark contrast in many ways, and it's good to make us, you know, think as well of the privileges and the access that we have. Obviously not everybody, but you know, with Trinity and the TAP program as well, the resources that come in. I know, Karim, that we have some people in the audience who would want to ask some questions as well, but I could keep on talking with you for hours otherwise.
Hi, my name is Jonathan. Thank you. Really, really fascinating and captivating. Your story is amazing. But I'd like to kind of make it a little bit more lighthearted, because what I'm curious about is when you, because I'm not from Ireland, I'm from Spain, but studying abroad is always very funny when you have to deal with local communities, especially with culture clash and stuff. What has been the most frustrating thing in terms of being from Syria, of common misconceptions or ignorant statements that people have told you that you kind of want to clear up the air and be like, that's not what it is, that's not what it's like? Just kind of things that kind of, like, that make you cringe or annoy you from, like, people saying just stupid things that you've, like, run into, whether it's a student or a person on the street, or just kind of, like, trying to, you know, again, because what you've portrayed so far is such a different image from what I think people expect. So what is kind of like things that like annoy you or kind of like just like, you know, want to clear up the air about?
I think like normally I don't like in Ireland people seem to be like so nice. They're actually like super nice, and I rarely get in situations, but like one example would be like, I'm not sure if that answers your question, but when people, for example, think think things that are wrong about like Syria and people there, for example, some people think of it as a very like religious place, and they expect you to be like super religious. I don't know why they have that like sense of Middle Eastern countries, basically, and especially Syria, and that's why the bad reputation that the war impacted, like, had an impact on. And one other thing is when, for example, people don't know that like Syria has beautiful nature and beautiful places. Well, some people think of it as desert. So I did meet people who told me like it must be so good like that you moved here in like in country where that has a lot of green space instead of being living in desert, which is kind of like so. I mean, I don't mind people thinking this, but like it's kind of really remind me of how like the war affected people's view on Syria. So like sometimes these things does like make it sad for me, because people don't know the beautiful side like of Syria, like the culture and everything, and just like thinking of the war and the problems happening there basically. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not sure if that answers your question.
Oh, 100%, thank you.
Okay, no problem. Good question though, because as I was going to like touch on that in my conversation.
Hi Karim, can you tell us what your parents think about everything you've achieved?
Oh yeah, they're actually so proud of me. Like, I'm not like shown off or anything, but basically because I really, they always looked at me as like a person who has like a very bright future. Especially because I always had like dreams of learning new things and meeting new people, and that especially getting like having the fact that I respect everyone regardless of their differences, and they knew that I'm hardworking and I'm a studious person. I really a very ambitious person, so they always. They're all sure that I will all like achieve achieve and they're really like proud of me because I now I mean I'm Trinity, which is like one of the best universities in the whole world, and I get to meet new people and like to live an authentic life, like studying things I want to study and like achieving my dream. And so especially that I also helped them a lot to settle when we are trying to settle in Ireland, like with their documents, especially because they, I mean, I obviously have better English understanding. I like speak bare English, where they had like a time where they're just learning and trying to adjust. So I kind of accelerated them living here, basically.
Karim, I'm Aoife, I work in the Trinity London Hub. I just wondered, when you arrived in the Irish school system, like what was the one thing, or if there was more, that kind of helped you to settle in? Like what was the one standout thing that made you kind of transition better, I suppose, into the school system before you did your Leaving Cert? And then I wondered as well, just I have another question as well, is if you have, like if you're still in touch with any of your classmates from Syria, or if you know that they, who maybe have gone on to other places, or maybe you are still there, if you wanted to comment on, you know, what they're doing with their education, or if they have similar stories.
So, regarding the first question, I assume you're asking about, how was, like, the time when I was trying to transition into the Irish educational system. Honestly, it was also a hard time because I applied to a lot of schools, especially that I also take into account the distance I have to travel every day. When I was living in Milltown, I managed to I was accepted in St. Union Schools. It's a school that that's basically located in Bilali, which is beside Dundrum Town Centre. So it was actually a very nice community there because like as I mentioned, people here are so nice. So I kind of have a lot of social anxiety when I entered because I didn't have friends in Ireland here, so I didn't know how it's like having friends from like different countries and and Ireland like is obviously a diverse place. Like people from all around the world are now traveling to. So first, like the staff was so nice to me, and they really encouraged me to stay, to actually appreciate what I was in, and to continue on my like journey through the education system. I also met people from different countries, and I didn't realize how like I have a lot of common with these people, and they're not like so different as I imagined when I was living in Syria. So basically, that's also a very memorable moment I had when I entered the school system here. And for the second question, I assume it was about the... sorry, could you repeat the question again?
Yeah, no problem. No, it was just if you're in touch with any of your classmates from Syria, or if you know if they've gone to other places, you know, just I was curious about their education journeys as well.
Yeah, so I obviously, like, some of them obviously are still living there, and I do have, I'm still in contact with them, and unfortunately, like, a lot of them are, like, struggling with things I used to struggle with when I was in Syria, and especially that things are, some services are getting worse with the electricity and stuff. But, and some, the others, on the other hand, like I have some people that that like moved to countries like around the world, like Canada and Germany and Turkey and like other parts of the Middle East and Arab countries, in the United States, and so so they're I mean they're actually I'm actually so happy that they managed to they're still in these countries, and like they're like doing well, but like sometimes some of them are still struggling with things like language and adjusting to the new culture, which I obviously understand because that's why I've been through. Like whether for all like my Syrian mates and all like and everyone like watching this is live stream right now, I would just say not to lose hope, because especially if you believe that whatever happens, you'll just focus on your life, caring for people you love. Like that's really the most important thing, and hopefully everything will be even better than what they think. I hope that like situation in Syria becomes better, so I can visit there or like see people that I missed, and people can like catch up on and make up for times like they had difficulties in. So just like just care for yourself and try to respect everyone, like whatever, wherever you are, and whatever journey you're going through.
We also have a comment on the Facebook, through the Facebook link.
And this comment is coming from Sinead Orr over in TAP, and she says, Karim, you are an incredible person. We are lucky to have you in Ireland and studying with us in TCD.
Thanks so much.
I know we're probably coming to the end of the interview, Karim. Thank you so much. But the question that Sarah had asked about your family made me think of a course, it's an elective course on displacement that I teach on, and I was playing a video for the students, and it was actually all Syrian families who are displaced. And really the message, especially with those who had children, was that they wanted their children to succeed. And it made me think about, you know, again, how important it is to see you succeeding, and how much that's probably, you know, it helps your parents kind of realize why they made the move, because that's something with displacement is you're separated from your extended family, which is so important in our Middle Eastern cultures, is
yeah.
to be around this extended family. So when you come here and see your children do so well, that's really a blessing. So really well done to you. And as somebody who's in Trinity, who's been here from undergraduate times, I would love to follow your journey to see where you go and what you will achieve upon graduating and after as well. And hopefully you get to visit Syria. In not too long,
hopefully.
And you know, it's your generation who has come out who will go back and rebuild, hopefully. So thank you very much.
Yeah, no problem at all. I really appreciate your encouragement, and I really hope the best for everyone who's in my case or whatever case they're in. So yeah, thank you, everyone.